For many people, especially in Africa, having children and living a happy life are non-negotiable dreams. But then life happens to them and the children refuse to come. Years turn into decades and the pain and the tears increase. Hope dying in the process. And there's the problem of the extended family and in some cases, an unsupportive spouse to deal with. Many women will take to Orthodox medicine, while some will choose to go to churches, to traditional homes, and many will even flock to miracle centers, all in search of a child. And this is not just women. About half of couples who are unable to conceive, you find that the cause is mainly infertility as well. In women, there are two types of infertility. There is primary infertility, when a woman could never get pregnant. And there's the secondary infertility, a woman who was able to become pregnant in the past. Sometimes, infertility is also called unexplained, when, after all, methods of investigation that they could not ascertain the cause of the infertility. As of January 2018, Nigeria's population stood at 193 million. But 20 to 25% of married couples, I said married couples, not those who are unmarried, about 20 to 25 of married couples are childless. And medical facilities also say that 45% of all female consultations are related to infertility. In a country like Nigeria, with one of the highest birth rates in the world, with women giving birth to over 7 million children in a year, Nigeria is certainly not a good place to be childless. The attendant social pressure, the emotional stress from childlessness in Nigeria can give you what I call psychological shock, especially if you do not have a great support system. Let me welcome you to today's edition of Pains, Love and Family. My name is Dimeji Daniels and we will be talking about infertility from my co-presenter.
Good afternoon and thank you for joining us again this afternoon.
Okay, morning, Hola. I will be mentioning your name. Adeola Adekunle is joining us this afternoon too on the program, and we have in the house a gynecologist, Dr. Femi Owa. You're welcome on the program.
Thank you.
Okay, let me start from the doctor. In the case of women now, what are the causes of infertility?
Infertility is inability to get pregnant after 1 year of regular, unprotected sexual intercourse. And for women, the causes could be divided into those that are related to the uterus, that's the womb itself, some related to the ovaries or hormonal factors, the hormones that control menses and the ovulations, like that. That also can be. And then the tubes where the egg that is produced from the ovary passes through to the womb where the baby will grow, could also be, that's called a tuber factor. Few also can be as a result of cervical problem, where the, that's the opening or the entrance into the womb. Those are the common problems that can be in the woman.
Now, for a woman who is not, you said, a year of unprotected sex, for a woman who has gone through that and is still not able to conceive, what are the options available to her?
Options in management.
I'm talking about treatment now.
No, okay. Treatment option in management.
I know that would depend on the cause of it.
Yes, it depends on the cause. Some, if it is just a maybe a uterine factor, maybe something in the womb that is blocking where the baby should stay, like uterine fibroid that is blocking the pathway, that could just be a surgery to remove it. If the tubes are blocked, if it's something amenable to surgery, they can also do a tuber surgery,
okay,
to repair the tubes.
The fallopian tubes.
The fallopian tubes though with very little success rate. If the ovaries is the one that is not producing egg, commonly there is something they call polycystic ovarian disease or syndrome, in which the ovaries has too many cysts but not producing oval, the egg itself. That one could be treated medically with different drugs.
Cyst itself is not harmful. I've seen women who say they have it and they bust of itself.
That's why I say polycystic. Okay. Now it is when you're talking about cysts that is as much as 9, 10, and it's most time affect the ovary itself in releasing egg. It could be a problem. So those ones may be placed on different medical treatment, as in drugs that can help to assist. Some minor surgeries like drilling or removing those cysts, you can drill, they call it ovarian drilling, they can drill some holes in the ovaries to allow it to work as it's supposed to. Some hormonal issues also may need corrections with drugs.
Okay.
However, if all these are tried and is with no success, then one could move to an artificial reproduction techniques.
Don't worry, we'll get there. But let me quickly ask this. I've seen women who say they have ectopic pregnancy, which is pregnancy within the fallopian tube. I hope I'm right.
Yeah, or pregnancy outside the womb. Outside the womb.
Now, what are the causes of this?
For ectopic pregnancy, that's pregnancy occurring outside the womb. If the egg is released, supposed to pass through the fallopian tube to the uterus, which is the womb. If there are previous infections that have affected the tubes, for somebody who have had recurrent pelvic inflammatory disease, repeat infections, it could reduce the movements. There are cilia, there are structures that moves the egg in the tubes as it passes. The egg don't just roll like that. So if those structures, the cilia, are destroyed, the movements may be slowed down, such that before the egg gets into the womb, it starts developing and it just stops there and continue to grow, not knowing that it's not yet in the appropriate place.
Yeah,
but
womb.
Because the tube is a narrow place, when it grows to an extent, it cannot expand like the womb, so it bursts. That is when they said the ectopic pregnancy rupture. Occasionally, the egg...
And that is harmful for the woman.
Yes. It's an emergency that should be treated as such. If not, the woman could bleed
to death.
But
how would she know while it's happening to her? Well, how would she know she needs help or she needs to call for help?
Well, as it is, it's also in itself. Though it's an emergency, it can... For acute phase, those ones that rupture, it presents with sudden abdominal pain that is usually severe to ask for help. Then, because it's an acute loss of blood, sudden gushing of blood, the woman starts feeling dizzy, and most time they report with history of maybe collapse, fainting in the public, fainting in the market, or somewhere like that. And when they get to the hospital, most of them will give history of missed period, even thinking they are pregnant, then with history of sudden abdominal pain, weakness, then collapse or fainting spells or attacks, that usually give it away. Although there are some subacutes that are not that classical, those ones may not be picked immediately, and they are not as life-threatening as the ones that have ruptured, that the woman could die within hours, if not attending to.
Okay, let's talk about infertility.
Yeah. Let me quickly ask one question about that before we leave.
Okay.
Now, how do you treat that? If the woman is brought quickly to the hospital, I've had cases, some people will say, would that not have affected the fallopian tube?
Yes. For those who had ruptured ectopy, most time it is surgical intervention. And then the tubes, which has ruptured, will eventually be severed off, will be cut off.
Will be removed?
Yes.
So what's the hope of pregnancy?
Now she has another tubes. For somebody who have the second tube that is still very good, is as the chance of getting pregnant is as good as someone who also have the two tubes.
Two tubes. Okay. I've heard of cases where it happens once, it happened the second time.
Yes, the chance of having a repeat ectopic is increased to about 10% compared to somebody who has not had before. That means 90 of them will not have repeat ectopic. So it's not that scary.
Okay.
If one has ectopic before, there are 90 over.
That's 100. Like 1 in 10.
Yes, chance that she will
not. But there's still that one.
But there's still that 1 in 10, that may have. That is why we'll, after every ectopic pregnancy surgery, you tell the woman to report immediately if she has missed her period. One is to confirm that the pregnancy is there and the pregnancy is in the appropriate place.
Okay, that's for the woman, infertility. We also know that men can be infertile as well. So if there is all of this, I don't want to call the breakdown for infertility in women is quite deep and, you know, a bit
complex.
How does it work in the man?
For men, it's not as complex as in the woman. However, when you look at infertility generally, it is not a woman affair only. Almost the same proportion is shared among couples, because literature shows that about 30% we have female factor, another 30% we have male factor, another 30% we have both male and female having issues, whereas there are some 10% that you may not even find what is the problem.
So the percentage is shared?
Yes, it's almost equally shared. Commonly in male, there could be obstructions to the flow of sperm, in which when the woman is tested, common test done in men is usually semen analysis to check the sperm, because that's what the man usually bring to the table, at least when it comes to infertility. So if the sperm is not good, or the sperm is not, the sperm that is producing does not have, I mean the semen produced does not have spermatozoa or enough in it, in itself is a problem. So in male, you can actually check, is there any blockage along the pathway, especially when you find out that there is no spermatozoa at all.
Cases like that.
Yes. Now all what comes out just is just the semen, is water. And when it's tested, they say no.
Okay. What could be the cause of that?
For most time, that could be an obstruction, which could be surgically
corrected.
It can happen. But sometimes you have low sperm count that is not enough, because it's like a struggle through a pathway from the cervix to the womb to the tube to get to the egg and get fertilized. So you need quite numbers, because it's not also a very easy way for the sperm. They die as they go along. So you need at least 20 million of those spermatozoa to be in that semen to fight. You see people have as high as 120, 200. So 20 million when it comes to sperm is not that much. It's not naira. So So when you have a low,
but I read somewhere that 50 million can still do it.
Yes, even from strict criteria can say 5-6 million sperm, but then it should be a good one, because it's not only the number that is counted during the analysis, the structure of those sperms. Are they looking normal? Heads, he has head, body, tail. Some may have two heads, some may not have heads, some don't have tails. Those ones are just, by the way, they are just following. They, even if they get there, they cannot fertilize. So they just need them so that when the issues on the way are destroying, so you can destroy those
the
ones.
Bad ones. The bad ones. Ones drop by the way,
so that they can have the good one swimming towards the head.
So the bad ones are just like the pawns in the game of chess.
Sorry, doctor, if I'm permitted to ask question.
Yeah,
I believe there are cases where, or let me ask it this way, are there cases where one might have given birth or might have procreated, and then later on the person becomes infertile?
For the woman or for the...
For both.
For both, yes.
Yes.
That's why he described in the introduction that there are primary infertility and secondary infertility.
Sorry.
Men who had some groin surgery, like hernia repair, hernography, it could be complicated. And the tubes that carry the sperm could be accidentally tied or caught during the surgery. So for such people, even if they have given birth before, you'll find out that they become azoospermia. They don't have sperm again.
Okay.
It can happen.
Okay. Okay. I read that on the average, when a man ejaculates, on the average, around 1 million sperm, but you said 20 million can do it, 50 million can do it. Now, on the average, that the man releases about 2.6 milliliters of semen. That's around one and a half, that's around half to one tablespoon of semen. And you will need this to take the sperm to where the egg is. Now, I read that in some cases, even when the egg is able to travel all the way to where, the sperm, all the way to where the egg is. Because of the nature of the egg, that the sperm may not even be able to penetrate the egg. What causes that? And what is the treatment for that?
The treatments are not that straight, like say 1 + 1 = 2. Now, the sperms, as I described it earlier, that it has head, tails, the heads also contain some hormones. They are protein like that digest the wall of the egg when it gets there. Usually the good one, when it
for
gets,
it to be able to
so
penetrate.
That the real spermatozoa inside can penetrate into the egg. If those things are absent on the head of the sperm that gets there, it may not be able to digest those eggs. Those ones would need definitely an assisted reproduction technique in which you can do the fertilization under direct vision, in which you can supervise the sperm fertilizing the egg before implanting it and taking it into the womb.
What about cases where the amount of semen produced, released by the man, is not enough to transport the sperm to where the egg is? I know that also happens.
That is not a common issue.
Okay.
Because averagely, you expect that between 1 to 3 mils will be produced per ejaculation. So it depends on the volume of spermatozoa per mil. The person may not have a large volume, but he has a prerequisite number of spermatozoa that can do the travel. It's not the volume that takes, it's not as if they swim in a big water to get there. The spermatozoa in itself is equipped in such a way that it can move. Like all these, if you look at
tadpole,
that is how it moves. So most of those semen, the watery part of it, actually come out to the vagina after sex.
Yeah.
And those are what some will tell you they have, that the sperm comes out, everything.
How long can a sperm last before it dies? I read that they survive better in a warm environment. So, how long can the sperm last before it dies?
It could last up to 24 hours.
Maybe before a woman starts ovulating, there was sex, and then maybe 2 to 3, 4, 5 days later, and she starts ovulating.
I know 3, 4, 5 days is a bit long. It could last 24 hours conveniently, but occasionally for 2 days. More than 2 days, most of those spermatozoa will have been destroyed. They will have died off. So that's why you encourage women who are seeking to get pregnant to have intercourse regularly, at least 3 times a week. Doing that, you know, the spacing will not be more than 2-3 days, rather than once a week or just on weekends as some.
Will it help for the woman to also understand ovulation period and all of that, because some women don't.
Yes, it's not only about WhatsApp and there are things you can read to even monitor yourself to know when you ovulate, so that you don't also travel far from home when you are ovulating or take leave of absence.
Okay, doctor, away from a bit of maxing out, let's turn to Diola. Diola,
yes.
Why do you think that in this part of the world, people seem to blame the woman more when it happens, when there's the issue of childlessness?
Well,
and somewhere we say, if their wife tells them, let follow me to the clinic, let's go and tell. They say, no,
I believe that was what made me ask the doctor that question I asked the other time. If it could happen, if you've given birth before, if you've been able to procreate, and then afterwards you become infertile, what happens? Or does it happen? And then to your question, I see it often. I'm a Nigerian. I'm from Africa. I don't know.
And even women do it.
I don't
women.
Know.
You have the mother-in-law coming around and
say, I don't know why. I don't know why it has become that way. I want to believe it's because of the fact that we find ourselves in this part of the world.
Because is it because we place too much emphasis on childbearing, on you just must give birth in a place?
I know of a few couples that even after getting married, they would tell their family members that they want to wait 2 years before they will start giving birth. And if you have asked or you have told your family, I don't see any reason why some people will have to poke nose and be asking you. But the problem we have in this side of the world is that once there is a marriage, once there's a they expect after 1 year,
but they're already looking at your tummy.
they're already looking at your tummy.
Asking you questions, and asking their son questions. And,
to talk to buttress that, when the doctor was talking about infertility, he said after a year of unprotected sex.
So
after a year,
wait for a year. In-laws will not wait for a year.
I don't know why the blame is always on the women, because I know and I've read that men are to be blamed in some cases, in some other cases, because I know of some people when they take too much of alcohol, when they take too much of a drug,
the kind of lifestyle they live,
it bounces back on them. But because of where we are, where we find ourselves, they turn into women. Doctor, please come in.
On a lighter note, maybe because it's the woman that everybody sees that the tummy gets big. And when they don't see your tummy getting big, they feel you have a problem. And you know, men, you don't see any difference from a man who has impregnated somebody and somebody, a man who have not impregnated somebody. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's why. And it's a man's world, sort of. The way we see the world.
Yes,
I see man is the one you can't touch. Is the woman that should have problem, which is not true. Most of the time, and men are even maybe scared of coming for investigation.
Yeah, most men will.
When you ask them, let's just check you. Say, no, I don't have problem. Treat my wife. Some will bring their wife, drop the wife. They treat. Don't worry, leave me. And then, you know.
I believe this one is another topic for another. What I'm about to say.
Okay.
You know, there are cases where they even say they blame the woman for the sex of the child, whereas we have to look into it. The men are too.
Yeah, people do that.
People do that. They also blame.
My mother went through that before she had me. Yeah, because I have so many.
They blame the women.
Okay. Let me quickly ask you this before we take a break. Is there anything that men can do to improve the health of their sperm?
Okay, for the men that are social lifestyle that have shown to affect sperm production. If you take excessive alcohol, it has shown to reduce sperm production. If you smoke a lot, nicotine has shown to destroy a lot of spermatozoa. So production also may be reduced. There are other things, exposure to radiations, especially those who work where there are X-rays, MRI, things that are high magnetic fields around.
Transmitter.
And, yes,
I
know.
Our engineering guys, I'm sure they are listening. The most are not married.
I know. They even talked about phones. That keeping phones so close to your testes is also not good. It has some radiations that can actually affect. So one
What about your diet? The kind of food you eat.
Yeah, too. Balanced diet as
and what about weight? Bridge. What about weight as well? Weight and what you eat.
The optimal weight, you should look at your BMI.
Yeah.
That you don't get
body mass index.
Body mass index. That you don't get too overweight because of the fat could also affect. Like that, but there are no strict food to say it's beans, it's
because if you go on the internet, somebody say if you eat garlic, eat a banana, yeah, your sperm will. There are so many things online,
and they are so contradictory. Banana looks
some people like will say this one is good for sperm production, another one will say the same thing is bad for sperm production. So sometimes you get confused.
Yeah,
in all of
just
that.
Eat as much as balanced diet.
Okay, what about the kind of underwear that you use? Because I've also heard that you should make sure you keep your scrotum suspended.
Yes, the place should not be too hot.
Yeah.
So when you're wearing
loose fitting underwear,
cottons, not nylon, like the one like swimming trunk thing that head that you're gonna be wearing that every day.
Uh-huh.
Why not swimming?
Yeah, okay, what about taking warm or hot water? I've also heard something like that. Is it related?
But those ones are just transient. I doubt if anybody bathes more than 10, 15 minutes.
No, drinking it like on a daily basis. Some people take tea every day. Or tea first thing in the morning.
Tea will go through almost the alimentary canal. It doesn't get that hot to get down. So one can just reason that out that way. But some have also talked about bathing hot, very hot water and all those.
Soaking yourself in warm water, warm bath.
Yeah, that also is a transient thing. I don't expect anybody to go and soak himself in the hot water for hours.
Doctor, why we talk about so many things to avoid or so many things to move towards in order to boost the fertility? I want you to talk about what
Before
we take a break, you know, when a couple wants to get married, they ask them to go for HIV tests, they ask them to do all manner of tests, whether you're pregnant, whether you're not pregnant. Nobody's asking them to do fertility tests or check whether the man can produce. So some people
it is assumed that both of you should be okay.
Yeah, it's assumed. Assumption. But there are cases where even the man, maybe the man knows that he's infertile, or the lady knows she's infertile.
She doesn't have the womb.
She knows that she just wants to go ahead. Is it not?
Would, now sometimes you marry these kind of people in church.
Yes.
You marry them in church.
I know you're a doctor, and then it's in the church that they say, don't test before you, and then it's right. And so a man goes ahead to marry a woman who doesn't have a womb. Can we say
it's like pouring water inside a basket?
A basket. Did you get my question?
I get your question. Okay. But you know, the way I will answer it, I don't know if it will satisfy you. I'm not a pastor. No, I'm a Christian. But I expect that in church, while they ask for maybe HIV, pregnancy tests,
genotype.
Yes, they assume that the person is married, doing the marriage like a holy
matrimony,
that they expect that both of them should have kept themselves holy. They should not be like somebody who don't have womb, that you are saying may have undergone some surgery that involved removal of the womb. Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't have to be abortion. Sometimes in cases of cancer and
other things. So they overlook those ones and believe that you are coming in faith, that anything that is there will eventually produce a child. Eh? That none shall be barren, you know? They will produce. I think that is why sometimes they just overlook that, and they assume that both of them should be okay. But it's good if
couples can take those steps.
Yes, if you can. At least it may not stop the marriage, but you can know what you are in for.
Okay.
You can know how to prepare.
Whether you're emotionally psyched to go through it.
Because people come in, do HIV tests, to find out that the HIV is positive, they go ahead with their marriage. It doesn't stop.
No, both of them or one of them?
It could be one of them.
You've seen that as a doctor. Okay.
It can be both.
A serious level.
You understand?
Love is blind.
So, but you know what you are in for.
Ah.
So it's not as if you are buying a black market thing.
Okay, doctor, let's take a break. We'll take a musical break now and we'll be right back.
It's so important for me as a woman to really be honest about the journey that I've gone through. Being vulnerable does not mean you're being weak. Being vulnerable means you're being real. And 4 years ago, around this time, I was told that I can't have children. And it's okay, it's fine. I'm going to have children, trust me. I do not accept. I was told I need to have this surgery and I have to be on this medication. I haven't had the surgery and I'm not on any medication. I changed my diet. I started to meditate. Everything is natural. And I started to really make sure that I didn't look after myself when I got unwell, that I looked after myself every day so I didn't get unwell. And the next song that I'm about to sing is probably one of the most personal songs that I've ever written. And I didn't even want to put this on my record. I didn't want to sing it in my show, but my band, who I love dearly, how incredible are they? Not just as musicians, but as people. They were like, Jay, you have to sing this song. So to any woman here that's going through something similar or has been through something similar or may go through something similar, please don't feel alone in your pain. And to any man that stood next to a woman that's gone through it, oh, it's not easy, you know? So this song is for us to be positive, to not allow our negative moments in life to define us, but to grow.
Broke me that day, I remember. I waited for my stubborn to come through. Told me why my moods ain't easy. Challenged me like I do you. The feeling takes me back to never. I pray I get the chance to bloom. I can be a six-letter word, four-letter word is you. B-A-B-Y, this just changed my life. Can't believe, I can't believe, I can't believe I don't have time. B-A-B-Y, I talk to you at night. Won't believe, I won't believe, I won't believe I won't have time.
Okay, that was Four Little Word by Jesse J, talking about struggles we tried bearing. We're still on Beings, Love and Family, and we're talking about infertility. Dr. Femi Owa, gynecologist, is still here, and my co-person, Monique Oladiola, who also joined us today on the program, is here. Doctor, let's talk about the options now. Adiola was asking before we went on that break for women. We've heard about surrogacy, IVF, in vitro fertilization, and all of these. What are the options?
Thank you. For women who are having challenge with getting pregnant, there are options to the management. Basically, if a cause is found, and is a treatable cause. If it's infection, they can just be treated for that infection with some drugs.
Okay.
And that's end the challenge, they continue to procreate. However, in some occasions, they may need more than just the drug. They may need drugs to stimulate them to produce egg, which could be taken as
When the ovary is not producing
as expected.
Okay.
It can be. But there are some that has total blockage of the two tubes. That even if they produce egg, there is no way the egg can get into the womb. For such, they will need an assistance. And that is where we come to assisted reproductive technologies, in which IVF is the commonest one, in vitro fertilization, in which the fertilization of that egg that they produce is done in the lab, laboratory. And then when the sperm is used to fertilize the egg, when it's fertilized, is now returned into the womb, bypassing the tubes.
Okay.
That is what is done basically in vitro fertilization. However, there are other additions to those in vitro fertilization, especially when you have male factor. If you have the husband who has a very low sperm count, you can do
where the sperm cannot get into the egg,
or the sperm is the blockage cannot be true, or you can't operate to sort that out, you can also take the sperm.
You can extract
the sperm,
okay,
which is there are different forms. There is one called TESA, percutaneous, or the one that you go into the testes itself, TESA, and get that sperm out. In doing such, you have access to good ones, even among the very low.
You can easily pick the
then
good one.
You can, under microscope, then do the fertilization. Those are other additions that you can have to the fertilization. Now there are women, even despite doing this, you have challenges.
Yeah, I've seen people who did IVF and it keeps failing.
The egg I talked about, the woman may be close to menopause, or the ovaries are no longer responding. They can't even produce egg. So, and you need a egg to be fertilized. In such, she may need an egg donor. That's egg donation,
mm-hmm,
from maybe a relative or a volunteer or somebody that will donate the egg that will be fertilized by the husband. Sometimes, I talked about a spermia, that there is no sperm at all.
Mm.
Such, the husband also may need a sperm donor. Mm. So those are other things, alternatives.
Are there sperm banks in Nigeria? Sperm banks? Are there sperm banks?
Most IVF centers in the country,
they have sperm banks.
They have, it may not be a very elaborate one, but they have how to get.
And you will not know the donor. You don't have to know the donor.
Yes.
And the donor will not know you.
Know you. That's also part of the
confidentiality.
There must be some confidentiality. If not, somebody can go on the road and say, I loaned him some sperm. Now you see what he's doing to me.
No, no, all his children
I actually wanted to find out about something. He asked if we have sperm banks. And I know we have blood banks. And I know how bloods are kept. I want to know how sperm are kept.
They are kept under, they are frozen.
Okay.
Yeah.
If we have someone who wants to undergo some treatment.
For a minimum of how many?
As long as.
It depends.
Okay.
Yeah. So some may want to undergo some radiation therapy, maybe for cancer or something, that can destroy the testes. They can harvest some of their sperm and bank it. So that after the treatment, even when they are not producing sperm again, they have sperm of their own
to use.
That's some advantage of having. Then the eggs too, when you do IVF, we usually fertilize more than one eggs.
That's why we have cases of multiple births.
Yes, you can put 2-3, and those 2-3 may even divide.
Yeah.
And that's why you can have somebody having 3 babies, 4 babies from one pregnancy. However, some of those fertilized eggs also can be kept in the bank. In case the IVF fail,
they
may not go
that
over the whole cycle again. Mm-hmm. They just start from picking the egg.
If you want to get an egg donor, what kind of person would be the best? What kind of age range would be the best fit for egg donation?
It's like having somebody to donate blood. The person will be screened, do other things. For somebody who donate egg also should be in the reproductive age group.
Okay.
And not a postmenopausal person. LD, and advisably somebody who has completed her own cycle of reproduction.
Okay, not maybe somebody who was not,
not
even
not
was not even had any child.
And though they will also have eggs, but then it's also not too fair on them to start.
What if they choose to sell of their own? If they choose to sell of their own, sell their eggs.
Now sell.
That's like somebody walking into a
blood bank. They get paid for it. Yeah, they donate and they get paid. Because that's no longer donation. Yes, that's not, like selling.
I'm not very comfortable with the farm business. It's like
saying because if you donate something, it should be free. Yeah. If you donate, it should be free. Yeah. But when you donate and take money, it's selling.
It's selling.
That is also not. It's against the law. It's not.
People do it.
Yes. It's like saying you want to sell your blood.
But okay, quickly because of our time, what about the risks that attach to IVF? The health issues. I've seen women who said they did IVF, the pain, the hormonal, some of the hormonal drugs that they give them, it makes them feel cranky and all of that.
Yes, it's not that easy. We should give it to those who have passed through different, cycles of IVF. Okay. Because it's challenging from the beginning. They are on hormones to stimulate them. Even after stimulation, the eggs are most time surgically aspirated. When they aspirate those eggs, they will fertilize, they will return. Also, it's not like food, so it will be returned with a minor procedure surgically to return it back into the womb. And then they are on drugs for quite a number of times. It's not like usual pregnancy that you just take your folic acid and all those imaginings and go away. They are on drugs, some of them are on injections for months, for the first 6 months of those pregnancy at turbulent time. And then during those periods, it could actually affect the total system. Commonly, there are some complications that could arise from that, from the side effects of those drugs. Most of them are treatable.
Okay.
So one should not, because of such complications,
not want to do it.
And they run
there. Okay, let's quickly talk about surrogacy because of our time. Well, surrogacy is when you ask a third party to help you carry your pregnancy on your behalf. And I read that there are two cases. Maybe the wife is no longer, like you said, cannot produce eggs. You can use the egg of the woman who wants to carry. That means that the woman is going to have a genetic link to the child. But in some cases, you just take egg from your wife and then your own sperm. That means that woman will not have any genetic link. But then in Nigeria, I know in some other places there are laws, because after carrying the child, some women may come up and say, a minimum law more, this is my child, I'm not willing to let go of the child. Are there laws in Nigeria
guiding
surrogacy?
To the best of my knowledge, there are no laws for now. Because it's still relatively new area of practice in obstetrics. And then, except for Lagos that I know, that are doing a lot of things and making and putting some law to legislate some law in artificial reproduction. Generally, the country don't have an act to say this is what guides surrogacy. But then, for anybody that is volunteering to carry pregnancy, for anybody, it is usually put in black and white. It's not...
They sign agreement.
Yes.
That means the lawyer must be involved. Yes.
Legal thing. So that you don't...
Do people take money?
The person is not supposed to be paid for such
service. Well, I hear people get paid.
But you can compensate somebody who is doing such for you. But
because it's like having your own child, body will change.
I don't
and
know
all that.
How will you estimate the cost for pregnancy to say this is I am paying for
the stress you will go through, the changes in
those
body.
Who have been pregnant before can at least look back and see it, that how much can somebody pay you for the stress of carrying pregnancy for 9 months, going through everything, then delivering.
Is there an option that you would advise anybody to take? Surrogacy.
Yes. If
in Nigeria.
If that is the... because it's the last resort, actually. Okay. Surrogacy, then finally adoption. Yeah.
Okay.
Adoption. Because if you are doing surrogacy, sometimes, or most time, the person may use She has egg. Well, maybe the uterus cannot just carry the pregnancy. Womb. She had had issues that involve the uterus being removed, hysterectomy, but the eggs are still there. You know, in such circumstances, she can actually have a surrogate mother to do that for, which could be a relative.
Okay, doctor, because of our time, we would like to take some calls.
0816251-9991. 0816251-9991. That is the number to call to be a part of the program this afternoon. Hello, good afternoon.
Hello.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, doctor.
Good afternoon. What's the name?
What's the name and where are you calling from?
My name is Akino. I'm calling from Akwamikwam.
Okay, the doctor is listening to you.
Doctor, I want to ask, what is the state of man who passed through
mastectomy in terms of reproduction? Hello? Okay, could you please repeat the question?
I'm talking about prostatectomy.
Okay.
What is the state of that in terms of reproduction?
The man.
I guess you're asking about someone who undergo prostatectomy, that the prostate was removed. It depends on the indication for the prostate to be removed. But most complications that can follow prostatectomy include retrograde ejaculation. Instead of the person ejaculating out, it goes into the bladder and the sperm comes with the urine later. So when the person had sexual intercourse, it doesn't produce a sperm. Now for such, if that complication happens, which can happen following prostatectomy, because the prostate is at the bed of the phallus.
Doctor, maybe you give out your number. Maybe the person will call you after. Let's take some other calls.
Hello, good afternoon.
Hello, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, what's the name?
I'm Shagun Kumakor.
Thank you for joining us. Please go ahead. What did you say?
If masturbation can what?
If masturbation can cause low sperm count.
Okay.
Yeah. Masturbation is self.
You excite yourself.
Self then gets released sperm. If it becomes an habitual thing, it's also equivalent to having too much sex. You understand? It can eventually deplete
the number of sperm
over time. However, sperms also reproduce itself over months. So the person may actually get more sperm, but people who masturbate habitually can also reduce the total sperm count over time.
Hello, good afternoon.
Hello, good afternoon. Okay, go ahead, we can hear you.
I want to ask the doctor, sir.
Yes.
If I get that correctly, I think he's asking if when you have sexual intercourse, when the when the person is menstruating,
I think we missed the question.
No, he was talking about a child, maybe.
And then you know, so if it happens, if eventually that brings out a pregnancy, and then if it will not affect the child, I don't think the doctor should answer that.
A woman who is menstruating, who have sexual menstruation, get pregnant?
It's not likely.
Okay.
Because at that time, the woman is not ovulating.
Yes.
We don't expect her to get pregnant.
Not even a percentage.
Diola, because of our time, maybe you give out your number. People who are listening would like to call.
Okay.
Call out your number. Go ahead. You can go ahead.
081 423 99 0813.
Once again.
0814239943.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Femi Owadiola. Thank you for coming. My name is Dimeji Daniels. This is where we draw the curtain on today's edition of Pains, Love and Family. I'm from Michael Prison.
My name is Kolog. You don't use my name. You can catch us on YouTube later in the day. See you next weekend. Bye-bye.